last night, then went home and posted on all of their social media about how much they loved it. So that will encourage people who said they might come.
Well, I'm hoping that you get. I'm hoping.
Please tell them. Yes, but they did love it.
They actually did. I'm hoping you get enough positive feedback that it was something you might be able to do again.
We could very much.
And I want to stay in touch with you, like about, you know, possibly bringing it to someplace like Haverford or something. I mean, like, we have to get some funding or we could have the three colleges. But if I were teaching my class on the I would really like to do that.
And I keep in touch.
Okay. No, 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 I will.
I have thoughts about how funding should be.
Yeah, yeah. And I could work with people in, we're very close, the three of us, we have a brand new little music center, and we have great, look, yeah, whatever.
Well, before you leave, did you say something? Yes.
But anyway. Okay, go ahead. All right.
Thank you. that's fine.
I think so, yes. If you can't hear me. Thank you, everyone, for coming out tonight to learn about the French Revolution. I'm very happy to be here, and I hope that this will set you up to enjoy this wonderful opera tonight. I guess I want to start by just emphasizing that the five women who are the protagonists of this opera were real women. And the opera imagines their connections and their experiences in a time of terror. And there's an inherently dramatic aspect to this moment in history, and these women were very aware of that. So my goal here in the next half hour is to give you some historical context to sort of be able to follow, perhaps, the opera. And I also want to make an argument about seeing this moment as important in the long history of feminism, because it is a moment where women enter the political process in a very dynamic way and then get sort of forced out. And that's I'm trying to highlight that tonight. I'm doing my best. This is a very complex topic, so please feel free to ask me questions afterwards if I can go into more detail on something. May I have the next slide, please? So I've organized the talk in five acts, and just to orient you, the opera takes place in section four of this, the period of the Radical Revolution. But I feel like to grasp what's going on, I need to give you some background first, okay? Next slide, please. So I wanted to just start a little bit before 1789. Because these women were all products of the old regime and of this intellectual movement known as the Enlightenment. And so I think I want to sort of sketch in a little bit there. The revolution in France did not spring out of a vacuum. It arose from a specific fiscal crisis and a political crisis. And it was guided by ideas that came out of the Enlightenment. So without further ado, let me say a few words about the old regime. So the first thing to say is that the phrase old regime, which refers to France before 1789, was invented by the French revolutionaries themselves. And they invented this term because they wanted to indicate that they saw themselves as starting a new era with the French Revolution, and that there was a rupture in time that had occurred in 1789. So in 18th century France, the French lived under an absolute monarchy. And here you have a picture of the last king of France, Louis XVI. And he was a monarch who ruled by divine right. He was accountable to God. He's cloaked in sacrality and magic. And he has the powers to make laws, appoint ministers, declare war. But he's not like a 20th century dictator. He just doesn't have that kind of power at his disposal. So you want to keep that in mind. There were like various bodies and institutions that could check the king's authority. The vast majority of French men and women had no political voice, no legitimate form of political participation. In terms of the society itself, I think the most important thing to keep in mind is that France in the 18th century actually had a 1% population problem too. That is, 1% of the population was comprised of members of the clergy and the nobility, the aristocracy, and 99% of the population, which was approximately 28 million people in 1789, that the rest of them made up this thing called the Third Estate, which included everyone from financiers, lawyers, doctors, to artisans, urban laborers, and majority peasants. The main thing to understand is that the first two groups I mentioned, the clergy and the nobility, the 1%, basically paid no taxes. It was a privilege that they had, given their birth and their position, that they didn't pay taxes. So the wealthiest members of this society could not be taxed as a source of revenue. And that's where this crisis is going to emerge for the monarchy. So it's a society that's grounded in the principle of difference and inequality before the law. This concept of society and this justification for inequality comes under attack in the 18th century, spearheaded by this progressive intellectual movement known as the Enlightenment. And the Enlightenment is an international movement. Philadelphia is an important center of the Enlightenment, and so is Moscow, and so is Edinburgh. And Paris was a very important center of the Enlightenment. So, I'd like the next slide, please. I forgot about that. I just wanted, back to my previous point, this image, which was produced during the French Revolution, but I think illustrates the social hierarchy of the old regime. You see a bent over peasant carrying a member of the clergy and an aristocrat on his back, right? And so this gives you this sense of oppression, resentment, literally his labor supports their lifestyle. So, the Enlightenment, these reformers, they believed in progress. They embraced a scientific worldview. They believed in human capacity for reason. And they wanted to direct that reason to improve society and eliminate abuses. And they called for religious toleration, legal equality, freedom of expression. All of the women in tonight's opera were raised in the sort of spirit of the Enlightenment, and they're reading these authors and talking about these ideas. Could I have the next slide, please? So Olympe de Gouges, who's one of our characters, had a very active career as a playwright before 1789, and she would go on to write a lot of political pamphlets, as we'll see, during the Revolution. Could I have the next slide, please? But I wanted to show you one of her early plays that was successful, that was called On Black Slavery or The Happy Shipwreck. This play, as you can tell from the title, Olympe de Gouges was not only involved in what we would call feminist causes, but she was also moving in abolitionist circles to outlaw slavery in the French colonies. Most important colony for France in the 18th century was what would become Haiti. It was called Saint-Domingue in the 18th century. So many of these women participated in what were called salons, or they ran salons. And salons were weekly meetings in private households for intellectuals, philosophers, artists, the curious, to meet and read things and talk about them. And there are real hubs of enlightenment. But I think the important thing here is the role that women played in running these salons and sort of hosting them. And both Madame de Staël and Madame Roland, two of your figures in the opera tonight, were raised as young girls attending these salons and meeting super luminary figures like Voltaire and Montesquieu, or like Ben Franklin when he went to Paris. And so they're reading this stuff and they're highly engaged with it. May I have the next slide, please? Another one of our protagonists tonight, Elisabeth Vigée-Lebrun, I just wanted to emphasize, was a celebrated female artist prior to the Revolution. And this is a self-portrait of hers. She was one of four women elected to the prestigious Royal Academy of Painting. And she was also the official portrait painter of Marie Antoinette. May I have the next slide, please? Marie Antoinette was the Queen of France. She came from Austria, which, as we'll see, was a big problem during the Revolution. She's the wife of Louis XVI. And I just wanted to show you these two paintings from 1783 by Elisabeth Vigée-Lebrun of the Queen of France, Marie Antoinette, because the first painting on the left provoked a scandal, and it had to be taken down and replaced by the one on the right. Now, it doesn't look very scandalous to us, but for French viewers who went to see this portrait, they felt that the queen looked like she was wearing her underwear or a nightgown, that she didn't look formal enough, she didn't look like a queen. And so, as I say, the portrait had to be taken down and replaced. But again, I'm just trying to show you that Vigée-Lebrun, working with Marie Antoinette, they're both elite women, but they're also sort of reaching for some new ideas about femininity, lack of formality, more comfortable clothing, being close to nature. These are all sort of new ideas that are emerging in this period. The only other thing I want to say is that on the other side of, well, coming out of the Enlightenment, one of the most important thinkers in terms of gender and women was Jean-Jacques Rousseau. And Rousseau's ideas were that women should dedicate themselves to the home and to child rearing, that was their natural destination, natural duty. He valorized these activities. He thought they were very important. But he denounced women who were independent, educated professionals. He thought that led to a sort of unnatural set of role relations, and that it would be better to keep men and women in what we would call separate spheres. I just mention this because Rousseau's ideas proved very influential during the French Revolution to the Jacobin regime. Next slide, please. So, the opening act Oh, and I'm sorry, the last one was, I just wanted to show you this. This is Lavoisier, the chemist, with his wife, Pierrette, who's your other protagonist tonight. Just wanted you to see this joint portrait of them as both a affectionate married couple and partners in this scientific endeavor. Okay, next slide. So, the revolution begins in May, June 1789, and it is provoked by a fiscal crisis. The crown can't pay its debts, and it can't raise taxes on its wealthiest subjects because they have privileges that prevent them from paying taxes. So it summons this large representative body with representatives of the various social groups to meet at Versailles to try to work out a compromise. But very quickly it becomes clear that the clergy and the nobility are not going to agree to any taxes. So at that point, the members of the Third Estate decide to form a new body that they call the National Assembly, and they invite members of the clergy and the nobility to join them, and they say that their purpose is going to be to give France a new constitution. And they take an oath to do this, and that's this image that you're seeing here. It's called the tennis court oath. Next slide, please. So then the revolution really kicks off. If you know perhaps anything about the French Revolution, it's the storming of the Bastille, July 14, 1789. After the events that happened out at Versailles, people are starting to agitate. The king is sending soldiers into Paris because he's nervous about particularly the working classes and possible revolts. And people panic, and they Parisians start looking for gunpowder. They end up attacking this fortress, which was a prison, because it had a lot of gunpowder in it. And the fortress stood in the eastern parts of Paris in a kind of working class neighborhood. But the main thing about the Bastille is that it's a powerful symbol of despotic royal authority, because it's a prison where the monarchy would lock up critics and opponents. It has a lot of symbolic force. At the time it was attacked, there were only 7 prisoners in it, but people felt very strongly about it. Okay, so they charge the Bastille, they get some members of the National Guard with cannon to blow holes through the walls, and then they gradually dismantle this medieval fortress prison stone by stone. This event sent reverberations around France and around the world. It was seen as something that people couldn't believe would ever happen. It marked the triumph of little people, ordinary people, over tyranny. Next slide, please. A few months later, this is where you see an incident that really directly involves women. In October, the price of bread is spiraling out of control, and famine is looming on the horizon. So a bunch of women gathered, waiting in line to try to purchase limited quantities of grain in the marketplace, decide that they need to go out to Versailles and ask the king to lower the price of bread or get them some bread to feed their children. And so they gather some pikes and muskets and pitchforks, and they drag some soldiers along with them, and they march for hours in pouring rain west of Paris out to Versailles, where they summon the king and the queen to the balcony of the palace, and they demand that they return to Paris with them. And so the king, the queen, and their children are escorted by this crowd of angry women and some soldiers back to Paris, And that's the last time that the monarchy saw Versailles. But again, this is an important incident in showing us the way in which the revolution is often moved forward by popular movements, threat of popular violence. Next slide, please. So now we're in the liberal phase of the revolution from 1789 to 1792. And this phase of the revolution is characterized above all by dismantling the old regime, abolishing privileges, feudalism, establishing the principle of equality before the law. And this is kind of, this document on the left, the Declaration of the Rights of Man and Citizen, codifies in 17 articles a kind of Bill of Rights for the French Revolution. And the reforms reflected a lot of the ideas of the Enlightenment, guarantees freedom of religion, freedom of expression, no taxation without representation, due legal process. I've put on the right of this slide, Olympe de Gouges, 2 years later, rewrites the Declaration of the Rights of Man and Citizen and calls it the Declaration of the Rights of Women and Citizenesses. May I have the next slide, please? And I've just put up a few of her quotations here because people often don't realize how radical it actually was for the time. But the first sentence, woman is born free and remains equal to man in rights, I think kind of summarizes. And she says, what advantages have you gathered from the revolution? Whatever the barriers set up against you, it is in your power to overcome them. You only have to want it. Okay, so the revolution then is going to get propelled in this more radical direction by a couple of events. May I have the next slide, please? The first of these, in June 1791, the royal family attempts to flee Paris in disguise, not a very good disguise. They're heading east to meet up with loyal troops across the border, but they're recognized by a postmaster in the town of Varennes. They're arrested and they're brought back to Paris. The bad thing about this botched flight was that Louis XVI left some documents behind, assuming he'd be out of the country, in which he said that he didn't support the revolution and he wanted to reestablish his full authority. So from this point on, we start to see the split between the two main groups, the Jacobins and the Girondins, in terms of politics. The Jacobins begin calling for the end of the monarchy, saying it couldn't be trusted. The Girondins are more moderate, and they're trying to create a constitutional monarchy. This liberal sort of phase ends on August 10th, 1792, when angry Parisians basically storm the palace in Paris where the monarchy is living and calls for the end of the monarchy, and the king and his family is placed under arrest. And then may I have the next slide, please? Finally, because this is referred to in your opera, a few weeks after the arrest of the monarchy, this pretty gruesome event called the September Massacres occur. France is at war by this time with Austria and Prussia, and there's a fear of an invasion. And so Parisian militants run around the city and go visit all the prisons and demand the jailers bring the prisoners out. They set up these mock trials and they slaughter these prisoners. Most of the people in prison were not criminals or counter-revolutionaries. They were basically people who, under the old regime, had been nobles or priests or just by who they were. The government at the time doesn't do anything to intervene or to condemn the September massacres. And that, again, is something that the women in the opera you're going to see feel very strongly, that that was going too far to condone this kind of, it seemed like, senseless violence. Can I have the next slide, please? So now we have the king under arrest, and the next big challenge is trying to figure out what to do with the king. The king is put on trial, and again, his trial ends up, his trial ends up tarnishing the Girondins and promoting the Jacobins, propelling them into power. The Girondins want to punish the king, but they don't want to kill him. They actually think about sending the royal family off in exile to Louisiana, which I always think would be like a great story, historical fiction or opera. Like, what if they had ended up in New Orleans, and would our whole country like be more French than English? I don't know. But that plan didn't go anywhere. The Jacobins prevailed. As Saint-Just famously said, no man can reign innocently. And Robespierre, Louis must die, for the nation must live. And this sealed the fate of the king, who was executed on January 21st, 1793. So you have an image here of the guillotine and the executioner showing his head to the people. Following the trial of the king, there's a purging of the Girondins. A bunch of them are arrested, imprisoned. Others are forced to leave Paris. And this is also when Madame Roland, who's associated one of the leaders of the Girondins in a gathering place for them, she gets arrested at this time too. Next slide, please. This is also the moment when Charlotte Corday arrives on the historical scene. She's also a Girondin sympathizer, very upset by the violence and the bloodshed. And she claims she has a petition, et cetera. She stabs one of the leading Jacobins, Marat, in his bathtub. You might say, why does this guy conduct business from a bathtub? He actually did, because he had a skin condition and he had to soak in these baths, and people would have appointments with him in the bathtub. But it does create a very dramatic image of her stabbing him in the bathtub. Marat was very closely associated with the violent masses. He had a newspaper he published called Friend of the People, and he was constantly calling for more violence and more surveillance. Charlotte Corday thought she was saving the Republic by killing Marat. He became a martyr for the revolution. Interestingly, Charlotte Corday, over time, will become a martyr for the counter-revolution, or efforts to, you know, turn back the terror. All right, so now we are in the period of the terror, and this is the moment, the fall of 1793, where our opera takes place. And there's a national draft in place. France has been declared under a state of emergency. There's a revolutionary dictatorship set up that's going to last for the next 10 months. And the decree is that we will govern by terror. So this establishes a culture of surveillance and denunciation, fears that there are enemies everywhere. This is also a period, fall of 93, when there's a crackdown on women's political activities. A law is passed that forbids women from joining political associations or from meeting with men or in any kind of forum to discuss politics or to be out on the streets protesting. Next slide, please. Under the Jacobins, there's a kind of definite attack on public women, educated women, women who don't conform to the domestic vision that had been promoted by Rousseau. They're seen as undermining the morality of the Republic. The most visible symbol of this female decadence was Queen Marie Antoinette. And so she's been sitting around in prison since Louis XVI was executed, and no one quite knew what to do with her. A lot of people were like, ship her back to Austria. That's where she came from. But it's decided that she needs to be placed on trial too, to make a point. And her trial only lasts 2 days, and she's executed on October 16th. And this is a sketch made by a very famous artist, Jacques-Louis David, who caught her as she was being taken on the tumbril to the guillotine out his apartment window, and he just sketched her quickly there in profile. Just a few weeks after Marie Antoinette was executed, Olympe de Gouges was executed, and Madame Roland was executed. So you can see there's this whole cluster of attacks on these kind of prominent women in this period. So the next 9 months, we see an acceleration of terror and purgings and denunciations. But at the same time, by the late spring, summer of 94, the French armies are starting to win a lot of victories. And so the military pressure is backing off. And as the crisis atmosphere receded, members of the Committee of Public Safety decided that Robespierre was becoming a dictator, that he was dangerous to the revolution, and they managed to have him arrested along with his main supporters, and they bring about his trial and execution on July 27, 1794, and that's what we use as the date to demarcate the end of the terror. So after the terror, I think I have another slide. What do I have here? Yeah. After the terror, we have a regime known as the Directory for 4 years, and it's a very difficult and traumatic period, but the basic goal of the Directory is to restore order and political stability and heal the wounds of the terror. The Directory is dominated by wealthy and educated men and definitely cracks down on popular participation in all forms. Directory is not a very popular government, but it kind of holds the peace for 4 years. During the Directory, an unknown general starts winning a series of brilliant victories. His name is Napoleon Bonaparte. And he's soon being celebrated as a hero. And in 1799, he organizes a coup d'etat that topples the Directory and brings himself to power. First he's consul, and then he becomes emperor. The only thing I want to mention about Napoleon, and then I'm going to stop talking, is that he puts in place in 1804 a new civil law code for France. And what's really interesting about this law code is that it has very harsh restrictions on women's rights, and it restores a patriarchal vision of the family. So husbands and fathers had legal control over their wives and children. Women could no longer publish books under their own name. That's why some women in the 19th century will adapt a man's name to be able to publish something. They couldn't go appear in law courts without a husband or a father to represent them, and they could not initiate divorce. Divorce had been legalized during the French Revolution for both men and women. Now only men could start these processes. So I'm just suggesting that many historians feel that the Napoleonic Code seems to be a large step backwards in terms of women's equality and understanding of gender dynamics. Some would say, I would say, seems like a step backward even compared to the Enlightenment when we saw, you know, these women being very active, etc. All I would say is that in the short run, women took a step back coming out of the French Revolution, but I think that their legacy or this moment is important. It entered the collective memory for the 19th and 20th century, later generations of feminist activists. And, you know, women's rights in this period were linked to all these other rights that we still continue to talk about. Women's rights really emerged as a human rights issue. And I guess the fact that I'm standing here today giving you this talk prior to an opera performed by an all-female run opera company is a testament to the legacy of these women during the French Revolution. Thank you very much. Sorry I went over. You can see there was a lot of ground to cover. But I'm more than happy for questions. I do love this stuff. Is there anything you want to know? My pleasure. They tried to dress themselves as bourgeois, right? So they weren't wearing like royal costumes, right? You know, so they tried to look like, you know, wealthy travelers, but not like royalty. But the problem was, and the kids were dressed, you know, some more like prosperous middle class people taking a trip. The problem was their convoy of carriages was massive, and they were very elaborate, and they were stopping along the road to have these picnics and like drinking all this fantastic wine from the cellars of Versailles and all this food, and then like kind of leaving the garbage there. And it wasn't a great disguise because it was a huge convoy that was moving slowly to the east. But your question is interesting because a lot of people, you have to remember, had no idea what the king looked like, right? There's no TV, there's no... And does anyone know how he was recognized? Had anyone heard of how he was recognized? Yeah?
Is he on their mind?
Yes, exactly. It's a coin. So the postmaster like sees this guy, it's a little suspicious, and then he's like, looks at this coin, and he's like, wait, that's Louis the 16th, because it was always a profile, and that's how they got caught, and then it was over. So yeah, that's why I say it wasn't a great disguise, because I think if they really wanted to get out, they should have taken one carriage and left everything else behind and moved as quickly as possible, but that wasn't how they were thinking. They snuck out of Paris at night to the best that they could, but yeah, it was a pretty visible convoy. Peasants working in the fields. It's not clear how much, but you know, I think that there was already some concern. People knew that the king wasn't happy, but you know, they didn't expect this. Yes. Yes, but you could still recognize by the size, the decor, the luxury of the carriage itself. They knew it was someone very high up, okay, even if it wasn't the king. So, yeah. Long time. Long time. That's why I study the 18th century and not the 19th century, because the 19th century is, at least in the French case, it's a kind of a big bummer for women. And in the 18th century, 18th century. I think it's true also in England, too. But, you know, they stay in place a long time, certainly till the late 19th century. And some, you know, women get the vote, I forget the date, very late in France compared to some other countries. I think Switzerland got, for women, the vote later. You know, there are activist movements in the late 19th century, but yeah, so in place for a long time. Right. 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 And until recently, there was still a law on the books in France that women couldn't wear pants. I found this out, which is like pretty amazing. You know, so. Okay. Do we have one more question? Okay. Oh, well, there's a really, I don't know, if you're interested in Marie Antoinette, there's a good biography called Queen of Fashion by Carolyn Weber, but she really talks about a lot of these issues. And Lynn Hunt has a book called The Family Romance of the French Revolution that talks a lot about men and women in different roles. If you send me an email, I'll be happy to recommend some things. But there is a lot. There is a lot on this topic. Sure.
Thank you. I want to carry.
Yes.
So.
Thank you.
had a wonderful pre-concert lecture about the French Revolution and the women specifically that wrote and lived and breathed this event. So it is a wonderful joy to be premiering Wilmington Concert Opera's Girondines here. Our church supports Wilmington Concert Opera. They are our artist in residence this year. So it is our joy to be hosting this event. We are, I want to just say something about Wilmington Concert Opera. They are a women and minority run opera company based right here in Wilmington. Part of their mission is to provide free or low-cost world-class opera concerts to the greater Wilmington community. So please spread the word. And if you are so inclined, donate to help continue this very valuable work, making opera accessible to everyone. If you are on social media, please take pictures, but not flash pictures, please, during the performance. That's very distracting for the performers. Tag them on Facebook, and we have the official Wilmington Concert Opera t-shirts right over here on sale. Yes, please make sure that you pick one up on your way out. Pay for it first. Yes. They have a wonderful saying on it. Veni, vidi, voce. Not I came, I saw, and I conquered, but I came, I saw, and sang. Written by Pierre Robinson, the rabbi. Pierre Robinson, the husband of, there he is, please stand. Of one of the members, family members of Wilmington Concert Opera. We are excited to share the story of these six real-life women who made an impact during the French Revolution. The story was created by WCO's co-founder and artistic director, Kirsten C. Kunkel, and composer and music director, Sarah Van Skyver. There are descriptions of the characters and the key historical events in the program, so take a moment before the lights go out and read over those. Also, make sure to turn your phones off. I made sure to leave mine elsewhere, but make sure you turn yours off because it's very embarrassing, isn't it? Yes. Wilmington Concert Opera has a history with this congregation. We began doing outdoor concerts with Wilmington Concert Opera during the pandemic to bring good music, opera, and light classics to the neighbors and the surrounding community in a time when singing was not really advisable indoors. So they have provided musicians and help for our free summer arts camp for kids who have experienced trauma. So we are just so thrilled and so proud to be presenting Girondines this evening.
Who lived, we're the ones who tell the stories of those who lost their heads, who lost their lives. In France we set the scene, the French Revolution has copious stories, you know of some, the reign of terror took too many lives. duty to tell their story, to tell you of those who lived and died. We tell it to you urgently, so you won't forget. Their names are happy in history, but today we make it plain. We're the ones who lived, we're the ones who tell the stories of those who lost their heads, who lost their lives. We're the ones who lived, we're the ones who tell the stories of those who lost their heads, who lost their lives.
Consider it That is my fear as well. Let us see if she is of sound mind today before we tell thee. Look the others over.
I'm so delighted you all could attend. I cannot wait to hear the news of your children. Let it be put anyone questions all of your presents.
Oh, yes, how delightful to see you, Madame Roland. Thank you so much for inviting us to you. But you know I much prefer coffee, as I am a lady of the people.
Oh, I cannot wait to share.
This charade is the only reason that we are able to meet.
Yes, Charlotte, please, I may be outspoken, but I would like to keep the Jacobis at bay.
We have much to discuss today, but I think we can all agree that the tides are turning in France. We are going to have to figure out how to proceed. How do you propose to do that without endangering our own life, Charlotte?
My dear friends, think we should carry on our individual works. I will continue to write, as will most of you. Elizabeth, keep painting at Versailles. We need to stay abreast of the situation at court. I do not see myself fleeing France, but if it comes to that, and you can go, go.
I also will not leave France. This is my home.
I do not see myself fleeing France, if it comes to that, and you can go, go.
Thank you. today I was to paint another portrait of the Queen. I had grand plans to add chiaroscuro in ways never before seen on a canvas, but not today, because Madame Guillotine must play my friend. Today I come to watch Charlotte Today I was to paint another portrait of the Queen. I had grand plans to add chiaroscuro in ways never before seen on a canvas, but not today, because Madame Guillotine must claim my friend. Today I come to watch Charlotte die.
Oh.
just gotta tape the other mic in place because the stand's too big for it. Alright, you guys are lifesavers.
Thank you. in Catalysia. I don't know how long they will keep me here, but I'm beginning to believe I will never leave France. They have tried me and sentenced me to death. They meant to kill me too.
Slowly began to
They said, Germain, what will you do? Switzerland is just not for you. How silly is that? I'm from Geneva, or at least I was. I said, how wrong you are. I'll find my tribe, if not my old friends, then I will make new. Regardless, people will always come to you. It's true, they do. People love to hear what I have to say. I'm witty and smart. As a conversationalist, and with a kind heart. They say I'm a woman of letters, whatever that means. They say that I have more friends than the queen. Well, I should.
should hope so. That didn't work out too well for her.
I like my clothes, I like to shop. I'm a moderate, but I so appreciate a bold frock. I'm loads of fun, but don't mess with me. I'm smart and wiser than you know. I'm loads of fun, but don't mess with me. You don't want an enemy. The one I could stand was he, the emperor. Napoleon Bonaparte, his name. I'm a Machiavelli, he told me. I should stick to knitting. Me, he exiled me. My 10-year exile and thought I'd be free, but then again to cope it. When Bonaparte chose Côte d'Azur, I knew that if he could, he would come after me. I hope to outlive him and thought I might his exile to him was a bright shining light. After that I became paralyzed and could not run. My body was finished, but my thoughts lived on. I had a great long is not